later on, I'll end up having a dolphin. Certainly, you have a dolphin. And certainly, sure, the plate will tell them this is part of an audience participation thing, and they don't have their dolphin. By the way, if you can track me down on the internet, I'm fairly easy to find. If you do go through past tweets, there was a Nicole Kidman movie about 3 years ago called Stoker. So if you go back, it's only confused by red hair nudity. It's not me this time. By the way, I will be pronouncing MySQL as MySQL. Occasionally I'll do MySQL, but the old timers at the company love MySQL. And because I work for Oracle, I have to have a safe harbor agreement. If I'm talking about a future product that has not been released yet, take it with a grain of salt. I do not have full knowledge of what's going to happen. So Dylan has a price, a stock keeping unit on it. Can take it with a grain of salt. If I say the word blue, I might think of sky blue, you might be thinking royal blue, and it actually comes out as blue cheese. And maybe today I'm talking about the MySQL Community Edition. If I do reference something in the enterprise edition, which is what you get with a support contract, I'll try to mention it. By the way, enterprise edition comes with a better backup tool, better monitoring tools, some other features are real handy. If you want to see demos of that, let me know. So today I'm talking about the MySQL document store, which is MySQL using NoSQL and SQL together. Now, traditionally, relational databases have been kind of a win-win situation for businesses. The original idea, 4.5 decades ago, was to save data with minimal duplication. Well, why was that? Well, disk drives were extremely expensive and extremely large. If you could get by without having the data in two places and having it in one place, that was a big, big, big win. Also, SQL, when it came out, was the first way to get multiple records back from one command. Before using things like index sequential access method or something like that, you got one record back per one request. Now, the heart of all this was built on data integrity. You normalized your data. If you had information like on someone's address, you would cut it up into first name, maybe middle name, last name, street address 1, street address 2, city, state, zip, which works really great in the states, a little less well in Canada, and kind of horribly bad in the rest of the world. Also, you had things like foreign keys, where you could reference a column in one table that was a pointer into a column of another table. Also, the core was transactions, where you had asset compliance, where either the transaction went through all at once or didn't go through at all. Very important for financials. And also, SQL has turned into a fairly powerful query language over the years. It's a descriptive language like CSS. So a lot of times when we have developers who are using their favorite programming language, whether it be procedural or object-oriented, and then they got to put in an SQL statement, they have to switch modes into talking SQL. Now, another big problem is that before you can use a relational database, usually someone who's the DBA or doing the DBA work had to go out there and normalize the data, set up the relations, set up the indexes, and do a lot of very hard work before you can even save the first byte of data. This could be a major choke point and a major pain in the rear. Now, NoSQL databases actually predate SQL. Those of you who remember the old Berkeley database used to key value stores. But about 8 years ago, the world rediscovered key value stores and said, okay, everyone's going to go NoSQL, rid of relational databases. And the reason we're going to do that is because we don't like schemas anymore. We don't like having people having to wait for someone else to set up a bunch of stuff. We also want to be able to save data right away. We don't want to have to wait for that DBA to do anything. It's also very flexible. We can embed arrays, we can embed objects, we can embed bit off, it doesn't really matter. It's just a big data bucket and pop it in there. And by the way, we don't have to use ORNs. And ORNs are kind of a bugbear time. Usually, when you get done with the overhead and the hassle, it's usually easier just to write SQL from the beginning rather than try to find something that maps between your language and your database. Now, we're talking about the JSON document store style MySQL database. It stores JSON. That's very close to the front end. And it's mainly JavaScript. It's JSON of JavaScript object orientation. It's fairly easy to learn. And for most programmers, you ask them, well, what's your main language? And they'll say PHP, Java, Node. But they're also doing a lot of just raw JavaScript. So people are used to seeing JSON. Now, this brings up a pink mismatch. Where DBAs see data like this, where everything's been normalized, set into separate tables, and grouped accordingly. And developers don't really see it that way. They want everything in some sort of document where they have little subsections they can get to. So what if there's a way where you can give each group what they want? Well, starting with MySQL 5.7 about 3 years ago and improved with MySQL 8.0, we've done that. So developers get all the schemaless wrapped stuff that they want in a document model. They get transactions. The DevOps folks get performance, robust replication on a known platform. And business owners are happy because they're not losing their data and it's easy to keep on time and schedule. So, this was all built on top of the JSON data type that MySQL introduced with version 5.7. And from there, we've added some other stuff that you'll see in a minute. So now you get a schemaless JSON document store. You don't have to write queries with SQL. It uses our new API, which we call the XDev API. And you can use certain tools to take JSON data and turn it into SQL style data, either temporarily or long term. Gives you a lot of flexibility. Now, a document in MySQL terms is basically a JSON column, one column and one row of a table, and the table is roughly a gigabyte. This is limited by our max packet size. If you need 2 gigabytes, use 2 columns. Mongo's is about 16 megabytes, and we have a gigabyte. That allows you to use modern programming style interfaces. It's easier to read than SQL. Also works with relational tables. We have connectors for a lot of popular languages. If yours isn't up here, let me know. We were arguing whether to do one in Ruby or not. We've actually had 2 requests for Ruby. This all works with our new shell. Our old shell is pretty good, but the new shell has a lot of interesting features. We're using it to add in things like the InnoDB cluster. It also has a lot of interesting utilities. I'll show off a couple of those later. And it has 3 modes, Python, JavaScript, and SQL. So our new model has ways to do non-blocking asynchronous calls. So if you have 4 or 5 queries you got to do when your program starts up, set those up, they execute independently and come back to you. It's designed to support basic CRUD operations. And also it's very easy to scale from one server to using InnoDB cluster, either multi-master or single master read write split, without having to change your application. When we started writing this, our engineers were looking around for who's doing good stuff with protocols, and Google's protobuf won. The great thing about protobuf is it's rapidly becoming standard for a lot of interchange work. And it also makes it a lot harder to do SQL injection because your data types are fairly strongly typed. Now, our traditional operational model is on the left. Your application talks through a connector, through the SQL API over our standard protocol, and talks to relational tables. Our new protocol, you talk through the shell or a script through a connector, and you can either use the CRUD or the SQL API through our protocol, and you talk to JSON collections and relational tables. way we'd like you to start thinking about using your database is that your application really should be ignorant of what's beyond its first connection. We want your application to talk to a router, either MySQL router or something like proxy SQL, into a cluster. Now the cluster can be here, like it's a simple three-node, highly available read-write split, with two boxes doing read-only and doing read-write on the primary. By the way, if you're using MySQL router, it will alternate between these as it can. And then you use MySQL shell to admin all this. Now, I have a couple of examples of various programming languages. Hopefully, you recognize PHP here. By the way, our new protocol listens on port 33060. Our traditional protocol port is 3306. So once you authenticate in, you say, we want to use a schema called world_x. And within that schema, we have a collection called country info. And what I want to do is I want to find any records where the ID is equal to USA. And I want to go out and grab these fields. I want to alias name as country, geography as geo, and grab everything under the geography that I'm using key value here, executed. So you've just done a query to the database without using SQL. For those of you who like writing in JavaScript, once again, authenticate in, talk to a schema named test, create a collection called my collection. I'm going to add three records, add with ID1, ID2, ID3. Once I get them in there, I can do a find with some bind parameters and go out and get the information I want. In this case, we're going to look for a name that starts with the letter S and then wildcard everything else. And the age is under param 2, so it's anything that's less than age 20. So in this case, it's going to pull up just this one record up here. Don't like JavaScript? This is the same code in Python. As you can see, authenticate in, add records, bind the parameter. And the good news is that regardless of the language, the way you do stuff, like the find command, is all pretty much the same between languages, so it makes it a lot easier for those of you in multi-language. If you need to do it in Node, it's a little more extensive and hard to read in the back. Authenticate in, talk to the schema, talk to the collection, add the records, do your promise, and then your return the data, and away you go. And basic C++ programs still out there? Getting harder and harder to find. Same thing in C++. Create the collection, add the records, do the bind on the find command, and away you go. And Java. Now, part of this is being able to leverage our new shell. Our new shell is kind of interesting, and our old one was kind of monochromatic. Our new one has different color codes. You'll see that here it says JS, this is JavaScript script mode. Log in, and I connect as root at the local machine. I create a schema called scale. I use that schema. I create a collection over there called Pasadena. And db.pasadena.add, year 2019, name equals Dave, boom. So I've been able to authenticate in, create a collection, and add records without having to go out there and set up the schemas, the relations, the indexes, and all that. And if I go out there and do a database, db, by the way, is a pointer for the current database, the collection in Pasadena into a file will return the record I put in. Now, most people probably notice that I put in year and name, but it automatically added for me a record called underscore, or a column named underscore ID. This is because the MDB storage engine, our main storage engine, needs a primary key. If you don't specify one by default, it will pick one and it will pick the wrong one, and performance will be hindered. So we've decided to, by default, use underscore ID. You can specify your own ID number, but if you default to the server, it actually encodes some information in there, like the record number, and some information about the cluster and the machine that it's actually working on. Now, if I want to do a modification on that record, Pasadena.modify, the records where the name is equal to Dave, and set the variable foo, or the key the value bar. And I go out and do a find, and there's food bars. Now, if I just log into the server and do a backslash s, there's some things I'd like to point out. The first is that we're using good old SHA-256 encryption by default. It's turned on by default. If you don't want that or don't need that, you can turn it off. Your bosses are talking cloud, but they're buying security. So if you want to make sure your data is encrypted, and even on a trusted network, you want to make sure that no one's listening in, we turn it on default on the server, and we turn it on by default with the next protocol. Once again, we're talking port 3306. And you also notice that everything for the server, the schema, the client, and the client character set are all UTF-8 MP4. Why is that? Well, that's the default for the JSON standard. Also makes life a lot easier for us. We've optimized MySQL 8 around that character set collations. And the main reason is because we want to be able to give support to a lot of different languages. We've had trouble in the past with some of the Asian languages where the word sushi also equates the character for beer incorrectly. So now you get all four planes of the Unicode support. And it also does the very important thing, it lets you put emojis in your database. Now, if you're running Mongo and you're used to seeing JSON documents, I want to give a quick little demo here. We're going to borrow their restaurant collection. This is a collection that I've been using for years in their demos. It's a list of graded restaurants in New York. If you ever go there, when you enter a restaurant in New York, also happens in California, you'll see a letter grade by the door. It's a white background, light blue letter. If you see A, that's usually a sign that the health department's been there. If you see a B, you kind of consider turning around. If you see a C, D, or E, or an F grade, you are definitely committing an act of gastronomic suicide at this place. So, if you're running Mongo and you export their db.restaurants data, in this case we're going to go out there and print out everything, and we're going to run through curl, strip out the object ID and the ISO date, and put all that into a file called allrest.json. You can fire up the MySQL shell, switch from JavaScript to Python, inscript the JSON library, the expression library, open up this file, read each line, and throw it into the database. I thought when I first saw that, that was pretty cool. Our engineers did that and were aghast. What they did is they put a utility called import.json, where basically you say where the file name is, and it's a very fast bulk loader. Reads in 25,000 records in 2.3 seconds. Now what's real funny is with 8.0.17 that came out 2 weeks ago, we now have a parallel bulk loader, which is even faster. So if you have JSON, CSVs, or TSV files you need to load in rather quickly, this utility will do that for you. Also now we support all the BSON stuff that Mongo's been using. So if you have their dates or timestamps or their binary files, it's no problem to pull that all in. So I thought it would be rather impressive the first time I thought. So we pulled in this restaurant data. If you type in restaurants.find and hit return, it would paint 25,236 records on the screen, which, believe me, right after lunch is real exciting to see. So let's run it with a limit. And if I do the same command, I'm going to add limit 1, but we'll go out there and give me the first record. In this case, it's telling us that we have a restaurant at this address, longitude and latitude, in the borough of Manhattan with Irish cuisine. And the name of the place is called DJ Reynolds Pub and Restaurant. And you notice that it has 1, 2, 3, 4 inspections. And thankfully, they all have a score of A. Although it worries me that this one has a 2 here, and the other ones are 11 and 12. Oh, wow. So, to get one record, we just post-end limit and 1 on the end of that. Now, let's say we want to search for just the cuisine. If we put in, we want to go out and get the names, fields, the name of the restaurant, the cuisine for the type of the restaurant. It takes the first two records it finds and prints just those two fields out for us. We can also erase those. Now, take a look at the difference between what Mongo does to find a record and what we do. I think ours is a little easier to read, and you don't have to pass a JSON object to be able to pull out what you're looking for. So if you're someone who makes typing, it's not a faster way of doing stuff. Okay, removing records. If we just want to get rid of a French restaurant where the cuisine is French and something that's not in Manhattan, we type remove and give it the parameters to go out and find the particular record we want. And of course, in this case, we're going to go out and limit two records. Now, our engineers did a pretty good job, and these are the railroad track diagrams for the various functions. Add is very simple. You're adding one or more JSON objects, which can also be arrays. Modify is a little more complex because you have things you can set, arrays you can insert, arrays you can append, things you can unset, things arrays you can delete, do some hatchings, do sortings, limits, and bindings. Remove is fairly simple, you give your qualifiers. Find, the one thing you won't find on here if you're using MySQL or the relational database is join, that is coming. But we have to reset up the various fields you are entering, group by, having, sorts, limits, offsets, binds, shared blocks, exclusive blocks. Part of this falls into our idea of having a comprehensive set of objects of how to do stuff. On the top, you see that we have a database object where you have a session that you connect to. And from underneath that, you have the schema. MySQL replaced the word schema with database, but traditionally schema is where you keep everything on the server. And under the database object, you can have collections for the document to store information and tables. Now the big difference is that the keywords for CRUD functions are add, find, modify, remove, and for tables are traditional SQL, insert, select, update, and delete. And you can do transactions. Here's an example where you have a very small collection. We're doing a session.start transaction, and we go to add a record. And if we do a find, we see the record that was already there and the one that we're trying to add. Now, if I do a rollback, I haven't saved the data, I haven't done a commit, I'm back to where I was. So with document store, you can do transactions. Once again, this is what we'd like you to start thinking of as a database model. On the right-hand side, we have the traditional existing applications talking through a MySQL connector to the server on port 3306. And on the left-hand side, we have our new protocol listening on port 3306.0 through the XP plugin. By the way, you'll notice that this is talking to the optimizer. It's not an ORM. That's folks asked me that before. Now, if you go to the SQL level and we say, okay, what's really going on beneath the scenes? For the MySQL document store, it creates tables for you with two columns. One is our favorite, underscore ID, and we have a JSON type that we created, we call doc for document. Now if you do the show create table, you'll see that the underscore ID is going to extract the value of underscore ID from within the JSON document. If it's not there, it doesn't smart enough to create its own value. And once again, if you have a value you want to use instead of what we generate, you can use that. Now this document ID is unique for every document that you have there, and you can assign it if you want. And we have functions that you go out and pull off those IDs if you need them. Now, how does this compare to using SQL or MySQL? Well, on the top, if we want to create collection, my collection, done, versus create table and all the parameters. Adding a record is much shorter. Collection name.add and whatever your valid JSON is that goes in there versus the traditional SQL insert statement. If you want to do a find, collection name find and whatever parameters you want to use to search for the records versus doing the select statement with the where clause. What if you want to take some values from that JSON data and materialize it in its own SQL column? Well, we can use generated columns, which was a feature that we picked up from our community, to go out there and extract a key from the JSON documents and put that value into its own column. In this case, we're using the alter table command, and we're going to add a column called borough. And it's going to go out, and anytime it finds the key value, the key of borough, by the way, the dollar sign here stands for the entire document that's being referenced at the current time. Anytime it sees borough, it's going to cast that as a var chart 20 and drop it in its own column. So from now on, if we want to index that or do whatever we want, that's reachable by SQL without having to go through the various JSON functions. We can also create indexes from within the document store. And if you go out and create the document in here on the JavaScript side, fairly simple DB restaurants, create index, give it a name, tell it what fields you want to index, is it required? If you say it's required, it will kick out every record that doesn't have that key out there, and how you're going to cast it. And if you look at it from the SQL side, you'll see once again it's a generated column, and we're displaying it out from, so it's looking for anything under cuisine. Now, does this really pay off? Well, if you run a query without an index on there, like in this case, it's going to have to read through 24,890 records. This is what the optimizer thinks it has to do to be able to prepare the team to do this query. And it's known as a full table scan. That's the type equal to all there. This is like having to read every page in the dictionary, and your dictionary is not sorted to be able to find the plural word moose. So without knowing the plural, if it's multiple records or not, if you're using the moose as the animal, moose as the dessert, moose as the hair, gel, you have to read everything. So the database has to read every record, which is very, very slow. Now, if we're using the document store and we add an index, notice we go from 24,000 records down to 192. Much faster read. Also, in the past, if you had an embedded array of values to traverse, it was very messy. In this case, like we want to go through here and get the restaurant scores or their grades. Very messy to pick your way through all the various values. Well, if we look at one of the records, we're going to grab all the grades from the first record possible. We see that there's one from March 2014, another one from September 2013, another one from January 2013, et cetera, et cetera. Going through that programmatically is kind of a pain in the butt. But what we can do is address it as an array. Grade sub 0 is going to give the first record, the 2014-03. Well, that's kind of handy, but it's not really as handy as it could be. What if you don't know how many there are and it's not the last one? Well, we have a keyword last. It says, okay, go out and grab the last one in this array. And if you want to do something like, okay, I don't need the first, and I may not need the last, but tell me what the second and third scores are. And since the array started at 0, 1 and 2 would give you the second and third scores out there. Very easy to traverse. You can do things like grade 0 to get the first record, grade is first to get the first record, grade is last to get the last record, and you can actually do computations to get select the first to the next to last. Now, the next thing I want to introduce you to is a function called JSON table. I've shown you how to take a generated column and turn NoSQL stuff into a permanent column. JSON table takes your JSON data and temporarily turns it into a SQL column. So in this case, we're going to use the JSON table function where you grab the entire JSON document. And anytime we see the value of name, we're going to take whatever value is under that key, cast it as a car 40, and call it name. So in this case, it's going through the JSON document and turns this into a SQL table that you can run through all the SQL processing you want to do. And once again, this is how it's going to cast all that for us. In this example, we're actually taking some other values. Once again, we have the name, but we've gone up under the address street and address zip code and cast those as car 20 and car 10 respectively. So temporarily, your data has turned into a structured table. Okay, this is something you can't do with Mongo, you can't do with a lot of other document databases for very sophisticated analysis. This is using three features from MySQL 8. A common table expression, which is an easier way to write subqueries. Windowing functions, which are used for analytics. And once again, JSON table. Now in green, I have a common table expression. We're going out saying, okay, we're going to run a subquery where we're going to take everything from the JSON document that starts with name and cuisine. We're going to grab those columns, and then we're going to do an average on the scores. And we're going to pass that to JSON table to go out and turn that into a SQL style table. And then we're going to push all that into a windowing function to rank over all those restaurants. And what we're going to do is we're going to partition all the data by cuisine and order those by the highest ever score. So this gives you the highest restaurant health code score by cuisine in the five boroughs of New York. Now, this also works with relational tables. So if you still have relational information out there and you're mainly using document store, it's very easy to say, rather than get a collection, get a table. And from that table, you do a select, and whatever columns you want, give it your qualifier, you can bind values to it, and execute it. Now, a lot of folks who have not grown up writing SQL find this much, much easier than trying to learn how to write SQL by copying stuff they see in code around their office and asking questions on Stack Overflow. JSON validation. For years, I preached normalizing data, third normalized form better. I can actually show you the math, but fifth normalized form will actually give you much better results when you have hundreds of thousands of records, and makes life a lot easier for you. When you normalize data, you say, okay, everything in here is going to be a five-digit zip code, and you try to put it in a string, the database will complain, or it might even kick out the record, depending on how you have your database set up. With JSON, you can do that. You could have problems where you're putting in strings for zip codes. You could have keys, like a key for email, AE_mail, capital E, lowercase mail, lowercase E, uppercase M, mail. There's really no rigor applied to the data. Also, there's no way to do range checks. So if you had a zip code of 5, are there 4 missing zeros in front of it? You don't know. There's no way to do that. Well, working with the JSONSchema.org's recommendations, we found a way on how to be able to make sure that your JSON documents are validated. What you do is you say, we're going to have a document that's our paragon or exemplar, and we're going to say, okay, we're going to have a key called my age. It's a number. The minimum is 28 and the maximum is 99. So it's between 28 and 99, it gets in, no problem. And if we try to insert a record, in this case 33, we say, is this a valid record? And if it is, it returns a 1 or a true. And if you want more information and a nice way of seeing it, we can actually run it through our pre-printing function. And if we try to do something that doesn't fit, in this case, I think I tried to put the age 14. It says it's not valid, and the reason is because it failed the minimum for that record. And you can actually embed this into your table description. So you can say, okay, we're going to have a table called test X, we're going to have a JSON column, we're going to have a string called my age and range, where we actually check to make sure that the age is somewhere between, it is a number, that's between 28 and 99. And if you put in 27, nope, put in 97, it's okay. Also, we've added multi-value indexes. So if you have records where you have someone with multiple zip codes, multiple account numbers, multiple phone numbers, you can actually set it up so that you can go through and very easily have each of those indexed, which means when you go to search for them, it can be much, much, much faster, because otherwise it's going to have to go through record by record. So, conclusion, what do you gain? Well, with the MySQL document store, you get data integrity, ACID compliance, all the transaction stuff you want. Schemaless, it's a way to do database interactions without having to use SQL. A lot of folks have it a lot easier to use. We have a lot of customers that are adopting this because they just don't have the time to teach all the junior programmers who come through their four-year schools or two-year schools without learning SQL, but they know how to run an ORM or they have a little bit of data structures. Also, by using this approach, you can get rid of many joins in your database. If you do the thing where you have an index that goes to a table, and from that table you have another index you pull out that goes to another index that goes to another table. If you have a lot of what I call stub tables, you can get rid of those and just throw everything into a JSON data type. And plus it gives you the ability to have highly mutable data on the fly. So if you're getting something from a vendor or an IoT device and it keeps changing the format or the amount of data you get, it's very easy to just put it in there and have to rearrange your tables. Once again, you can also use our functions for the JSON data types on non-JSON data. So in this case, I'm creating a JSON object. I'm feeding the string city and the value name from city, and I'm suddenly creating JSON objects from my non-JSON data. Also, we support GeoJSON for anyone who's into that. And we have a whole bunch of new features in MySQL 8. We're running short on time. I'd like to introduce you to histograms, which are like indexes, but without the overhead. And we also have resource groups where you dedicate certain CPUs to certain batches of queries, and you signify what group of queries in by putting a comment in your SQL statement. And with that, I'd like to introduce you to buy my book if you're interested in the JSON data type. I have a couple here to give away. I only have three, so if you really want a copy, come see me. If you're using the JSON data type and really want to see great examples, our manual is good, but doesn't have a lot of comprehensive examples on how to use it. My book does. And with that, I want to thank you all for coming out. And what questions do you have? Yes, sir.
Is using SQL, is there a difference in safety using SQL versus correct syntax?
Using SQL versus what syntax?
Correct. Using the NoSQL syntax. Is there like a different safety in this project?
No, they talk the optimizer at the same level, and there's really no performance difference at that.
I mean like safety, like security like that.
Security wise, it's probably a little stronger on the X protocol, because the protocol has variables going across that are more strictly typed. So slightly less risk of SQL injection. Yes, sir.
So, somewhere I read about AnimalDB, their preference was to store everything in a single table. Is there performance? Is there something with that sort here as well, or try to shove everything into a single table?
Depends on how you want to architect your data. Throwing everything into one big pile works for a certain level, but it gets hard to scale, it's hard to optimize, it's hard to move around. It's like your 13-year-old kid who throws everything in the center of his room. But damn, I know where everything is. Yeah, but it drives them off the wall and you can't retrieve things when I want you to do. So you could do that, it depends on how you want to architect. I usually tell people separate things as much as you can just for modularity. Any other questions?
Sorry, one last thing. Why was the change to port 3060?
Well, we want to keep the old protocol around. And we want to have a new port for a protocol. And with the various proxy engines, MySQL Router and Proxy SQL and a couple of others, which you'll see, you have the application talk to the proxy and talk to the either port 3306 or 30604. So. Well, with that,
go ahead. I was going to say, so I deal a lot with like the reading data, say like, I don't know, 10,000 records a day. It's coming into JSON. But I've created a normalized database, my interface records, so taking the JSON, throwing it in a database, so we query it. If I just dump it in like this, which looks really like, oh, that'd be so nice.
Yeah.
But how is it going to, the performance on the backside when you go back to query it, how's that going to turn out?
Depends, like I said, if you pull out everything out with generated columns, there's a little bit of overhead where you're actually putting that data and actually creating your own data. If you're just reading it, with just a primary key and everything else in JSON document, there might be like a 3 to 4% overhead. My trouble is I've got here some benchmarks has me on the bottom of the list. I'm not quite sure what they
are. Yeah, I just feel like if it's a big amount of queries or functions and stuff, the tables like created, like, those queries can be fast.
Yeah. Well, the great thing about this is you have the flexibility. So if you have stuff that you know is going to change, you can throw it in JSON and get it and not worry about it. So, depends on how you are. Yes, sir.
So I write a lot of big SQL queries with CTE blocks, right? With blocks, I was wondering if we're accessing one of these document tables inside there, is like predicate pushdown still work, or is my query going to end up hitting me and scanning the entire document table?
The pushdown should work.
Okay.
Yeah. And when in doubt, when it's playing on, to make sure that it's hitting the index that you expect it to. Also, in MySQL, we have invisible indexes, so if you have an index you're not quite sure is working, rather than blow it away and mark invisible to the server, you want to explain all that, and if it's valuable, you keep it there. If it's not valuable, keep it invisible for a little bit longer, because you might find out a week, a month later, that someone else uses that query running away. Mm-hmm. So that's another tool to make sure your query is running away. Cool. Well, thank you all very much. I have another talk tomorrow on care and feeding of MySQL database for busy Linux admins. If you have any other questions, I'll be around here the rest of the day and tomorrow. Thank you all for coming out.